Hi, in this video I'm going to show you how to use some of the normal distribution functions in Cell. More specifically, the NORM.DIST, NORM.S.DIST, NORM.INV, and NORM.S.INV functions. So I think the most useful function that I found here is using the NORM.DIST function. And this can help you answer questions like, for example, a good one is an IQ question. So for example, someone says, oh, I've got an IQ of 131. And you want to say, okay, well, based on some population samples, what's the probability that this person falls in that particular range? Well, with IQ, the kind of popular IQ test is that the mean IQ is 100 with a standard deviation of 15. So in using the norm.dist function, what we can do is put norm, use norm.dist, and what is x? X is, I'm going to put it here because I'm going to change it a little bit. X is going to be my value. I'll put 131 in there later. The mean is 100. Standard deviation is 15. And is it cumulative? Yes. And I'll show you why we're going to use that. So basically what this is saying is about what's the chance that people that have a score of x is part of a normal distribution in this IQ test. Now, when I press enter, you see it shows nothing because there's no value in there. So as I mentioned previously, someone says, oh, I'm 131. Well, if they're 131, that means 98% of the population have an IQ of 131 or less. But that just says that 98% of the population have a IQ of 131 or less. So that's a big range. So when you think about it, what does that mean? So visually, this is what it means. I've brought up a website here that kind of shows it a little bit nicer. Let's go to that site, particularly with that graph, right? So what it's saying is 98, well, let's do 130. That, since we have 130 here and it's part of the standard deviation, I'm gonna go change this back to 130. So it's gonna say 97.7% of the population have an IQ of 130 or below. So basically what I'm saying is anything to the left of this is about 97.7% of the population. So that's what basically it's saying. That's where this particular true function comes into play. Now, if someone said, let me press escape, but if someone said that they had an IQ of 130 and you wanted to see what's the probability of having that specific IQ, you're going to use the norm.dist function, still use that. The mean is 100, standard deviation is 15, and instead of having true for the cumulative, you're going to choose false for the probability mass function. So that's going to say, what are the chances of that person having exactly 130 IQ? So it's going to be less than 1%. So if I put these in percentages, you'll see that it is less than 1%. Let's move it up. More specifically, 0.36%. So I find that actually quite useful, the norm.dist function. As long as you know what the mean is and what the standard deviation is, you can plug in a value and it'll give you the probability or the chance that that value, where does that sit in the normal distribution of that sample. Now, what norm.s.dist function, it's kind of a special version of this, and it's assuming a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. So if I do equal norm.s.dist, you can see there is no option for a mean or standard deviation because it's assuming 0 and 1, respectively. So it's just going to ask you for the z-score. I'll put it in here to reference it. And it's going to do the same thing. Is it a cumulative, or is it true for a cumulative distribution function, or is it false for probability? I'm going to put true for now. Press enter. And you see it's 0.5 because it probably assumes a 0 here. But if I say something like 1, right, you're going to have 0.8413. If I go to a bell curve that looks at the standard normal distribution, you'll see that it aligns that. All right, 0.841 with a z-score of 1. So if we look at this, so you see that we have a standard z-score of 1 and a z-score of 2. It approximates to the standard deviation 1 and standard deviation 2. So you can see that the z-score of 1 gives me 84.1. If I put a z-score of 2, it'll give me 97.7. If I go back to the Excel spreadsheet, you'll see if I put in the z-score of 2, you're going to see 97.7. So that's what it's doing. Now, with the true, if I put in true for this, norm.s.dist, and use my z-score of 2, and cumulative, put false, what is the value there? Basically, what's saying, if it's exactly 2, it's going to be 0.05. And that's kind of analogous to what we had here. So if you put in a z-score value of that, what is the standard normal distribution value of that? Now, the norm.inverse function, or norm.inv function, is just the inverse of this. So if I type in norm.inverse, the probability I'm going to put over here, the mean, let's put in the mean of 100 and standard deviation of 15. We'll follow the IQ sample or example. Press enter. You notice that it's a number because I didn't put in my probability, right? So if I said, my probability is 97.72, or I'll just equal to that value here, the output here I should get is 130. So it's just the inverse of that. So unlike the norm.dist function, where you are trying to find out the probability that it falls under that bell curve, you have a probability that you're looking at and trying to find out what number represents that probability. Now the norm.s.inv function is just inverse of that. So if I did norm.s.inv, I'm just looking at my probability. If I say this value, and it's going to be it's going to be giving me an error, but if I set equal to that value here, it's going to bring back the 2, which is the inverse of that. So that's what basically it's doing. So I find the most useful are the norm.dist functions and the norm.inv functions if you're looking at samples and you're doing your own kind of experiments. If you kind of wanted to find out what the normal distributions are for a standard normal distribution, these norm.sinv or norm.sdist functions probably would give you some reference points. So I hope that helps. Thanks for watching.